50-mile radius. They've been coming from Raleigh and Wilson and Roanoke Rapids and Durham and Roseville and Zebulon and Knightdale and Bailey. We've discovered that a church alive is worth the drive. And so I want to personally invite you to join us in worship Sundays at 9 a.m., Tuesdays at 7 p.m. right here, Word Tabernacle Church, 821 Word Plaza in Rocky Mount.
This is
WRSV Elm City.
Turn up!
Choice FM.
In your family's time of need, who can you call? Lori's Funeral Home and Cremation. With two convenient locations, 1014 Garner Road in Raleigh and 711 South Railford Street in Selma. Funerals, green burials, along with funeral cremation and direct cremation services. Lori's Funeral Home and Cremation is experienced, compassionate, and ready to serve your family in a time of need. Vaults, affordable casket, headstones, and cremation options. Lori's has spacious chapels to keep you safe during COVID. When it's that time, call someone you can trust. 919-832-0636 at 919-980-1764.
Choice.
What's happening, you beautiful souls? It's the DOC on WRSV reporting to you live from the wonderful, wonderful island of Jamaica. Kingston, to be specific, for the Island Music Conference 2024 that is unfortunately wrapping up and coming to a close. Folks, it's been an incredible weekend. Shout out to Choice FM. Shout out to Judith Bodley. Shout out to Sharon Burke. Shout out to Shaggy, Sean Paul, Wyclef, everyone who came through, showed love, were part of the wonderful panels, where we're giving gems and knowledge and information and sharing the culture and the education and all of the infrastructure and literally sharing the vibes of the island to myself and those of us who attended the conference. Man, it felt incredible. It's unlike anything else what I've read in the papers, seen on movies and films and all that stuff. It's similar to what everything else is, you know. They try to over exaggerate or make it seem like it's worse than it actually is, but no, bro, this is just like being in the city. You go to Atlanta, you go to Charlotte, you go to Raleigh, you go to Rocky Mount, you go anywhere, you just watch what you're doing, you know. Pay attention, don't be all heads in the clouds. No, watch where you're going, read the room, make sure you're around good folks, good people going to watch out for you, take care of you, whatever the case may be, you hear me. And you can survive literally anywhere, bro. I'm in the middle of it all, bro. I've been to the sticks, I've been to the bricks, I've been all throughout it. I got, man, look, I'm gonna tell y'all some stories coming up in the next week, but like, kick it, relax, enjoy yourselves. Let's go ahead and get into some music, man. It's the DOC on WRSV live from Kingston, Jamaica for the Island Music Conference 2024 on behalf of Choice FM.
Taking over like and what?
Wake Forest.
Gas now has Choice.
Gas me up.
Choice FM.
Rich Process.
I'm unavailable. They know they see me.
Well, good, happy Monday, February 26th to everyone. This is James Galliard, and welcome to the James Galliard Show. I am thrilled that you are joining us here on Choice FM. You can find us on the web, ilovechoicefm.com, or on the FM dial, 92.1 FM. It's the People Station. This is the show every Monday from 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock on your drive-in, or just before you have dinner, or while you're making dinner, that we talk about the issues that matter. The objective of our show is not to get you to agree with the host on everything the host says. I think we're in trouble, quite frankly, if we agree with anyone all of the time, if we agree with any author all the time. Y'all know I'm a pastor, and I don't agree with every commentator all of the time. But I do think we are at a point in our society, folk, where we cannot entertain ourselves to a better life. We cannot entertain ourselves to a better existence. We've got to educate ourselves. And this show is about some form of edutainment, if you will. It's me trying to entertain us just a little bit, but using it a entertainment as a mechanism to educate us. And so I like on this show to talk about the things nobody wants to talk about, or very few people want to talk about: politics and religion and sports and culture and news and just what's happening in the world and how those events affect our family lives, how they affect our address. And so I do take a few calls as well. And so if you're in the 252, the number is 937-7400. And if you're in the 919, the number is 872-9210. If you're new to the show, join us on YouTube or join us on Facebook or wherever you are. Type in, hey, I'm new. I'll be checking out those comments in a little while when we take a break. But I always start the show with, since we were together last, and to kind of talk about what we did on Saturday and Sunday and the weekend and what we did this past week. And I want to shout out everybody that's listening. Happy Monday to everybody. You know, I say that to everybody except people that put sugar on grits, except the people that put ketchup on hot dogs, except the people that use Duke mayonnaise and not Hellman's mayonnaise. And I'm going to add one today, except the people that need a knife and a fork to eat a piece of meat that has a bone in it. I don't know about you. I grew up, Mama would be frying those pork chops. She'd be frying that fried chicken. And there wasn't no fork. There wasn't no knife involved. It was just you picking up that meat with a bone. My mama said, boy, that meat, that bone in, pick it up. Or she might slap a piece of white bread. That y'all know, before Bojangles, before Chick-fil-A, before Popeyes, before KFC, let me help you save some money. Get you a big pack of chicken, fry those chicken, them drumsticks up, get you a piece of white bread, some Stroman's bread, some Wonder Bread, and make you, get you some hot sauce, and that's the original chicken sandwich. And it'll be much better than any chicken sandwich you have anywhere else. So I'm shouting everybody out. What did your pastor preach? What did your pastor preach on Sunday? And I'm wondering, does your pastor preach messages that challenge you? Do you consider them steak messages, or do you consider them cotton candy messages? Are you being challenged to live better? Are you being challenged to treat people right? Are you being challenged to manage your money right? Are you being challenged to keep your word? Are you being challenged to engage in politics? You know, I talk a lot of politics on this show. We need to be talking politics from our pulpits, not telling people who to vote for, but making sure that everyone is voting. Matter of fact, I don't want to break bread with any person who doesn't vote. And so I want to encourage you, wherever you are, you're listening from Rocky Mount, Tarboro and Wilson, Raleigh and Durham, you're listening to Roanoke Rapids. Listen, if you are not voting, I am not trying to rock with you. No space, no time for any human being that does not vote. I don't want them singing in my choir. I don't want them playing my instruments at my church. I don't want them leading in my congregation. I don't want them sitting at my dinner table. We have to make sure we elevate this whole conversation about voting. And so Sunday I preached on it won't be easy, but I'm coming out. And I talked about the exodus of the children of Israel and how we relate that to the over 400 years of captivity of African-American people in this nation, how from 1450 to 1850, we were stripped across the Western Hemisphere, across the Atlantic Ocean, from the shores of Benin and the Congo, and how we have such a rich history that we need to embrace, and how there is still a Pharaoh in our midst. You know, when you go to make that purchase and at that buy here, pay here car place, and it's a 25% interest rate, that is a form of Pharaoh in our communities. When they are charging exorbitant rates for us to have checks cashed, and we're not going to banks, and we're not banked, or we're underbanked, that is a form of Pharaoh trying to hold us in captivity. When our school systems are not being properly funded, I'm going to talk about that today, that is a form of Pharaoh trying to hold us in captivity. So I dealt with that yesterday, and I hope your pastor dealt with something that was enlightening, that was empowering, that was equipping, that was encouraging to you. And so that was my weekend. I got a chance to hang out with the youth in our church. Man, they're doing amazing things. Can I just say this to you? And I'll share more about this later, but get you a black church. Can I just say that to folk? Get you a black church. And my mama was white. No racist bone in me, no bias in me. there's just a power associated with the African-American church that just doesn't exist anywhere else. As a matter of fact, when I'm talking to my white friends, they're oftentimes, hey, Pastor Galea, what can we do to help race reconciliation? What can we do to empower groups of people so there's less division? You know what I tell them was at the top of my list? This is what I say to white people. Top of my list, this is what I say. Join a black church. Serve in that church. Commit to that church. I really believe that the path forward, not just in the African-American community, but in our nation, is through the black church. And so I just want to hang out with our young people that are doing amazing things. We had lunch. We celebrated them. And so that was my weekend. It was a great weekend. I hope yours was as well. I was reflecting this weekend, though, as I shift gears with you, on Beyoncé. Beyoncé has become the first black woman artist ever to top Billboard's Hot Country Songs chart in modern history, Texas Hold'em. So what do y'all think about that song? I don't personally love songs with profanity, but I love to be, I may lose my black card. I actually like country music. I like country music because I'm a lyricist. And when I say I'm a lyricist, not that I write, but that I love lyrics. Like, I love lyrics above a beat. I love lyrics above rhythm. I love lyrics above, I want to hear what the person's saying, right? I don't just want to, you know, swerve and move and grind and, no, and gyrate. No, I want to know, what are you saying? What are you communicating? And so, I'm a lyricist. So because of that, I really like country music because I've learned to like the lyrics in country music. And so, Zach Bryan and Kacey Musgraves were at the top of the charts. She had dethroned them, and the Beehive is going crazy as she has now entered into this country music vibe. Y'all, the reason I celebrate Beyoncé for this is because no group of people, you know, there's a group of people in our nation that has this, like, spirit of privilege. Like, they have, we saw that with tennis. We saw it with golf, right? That people feel like this is our genre. You know, like, black people don't have no problem giving Eminem props, right? If he want to enter into the rap game. And we will embrace all kinds of artists from every background. But it's something about other groups of people who feel like there's some stuff we do, our ice is just a little bit colder, and this is just for us. I love the fact that she broke through. She didn't just break through, but she hit number one. And if you don't know, like, there is a real racist bias with country music. I was just recently, I was looking back at 2023 last year, and there was a point on the top of the charts in country music in 2023 where, like, there were, like, songs that were released that were pro-violence, that were anti Black Lives Matter, and they were hitting top of the charts in country music. They were anti-black people, they were anti-Black Lives Matter, and they were hitting country top of the charts. Just recently, an interview occurred on a conservative network. That network is called The OWN, not OWN, not Oprah's network, but OAN, One American News, OAN, One American News. And there was an interview, and the person interviewed, which was Schneider. He's a country music artist, but he was on Dukes of Hazzard, I believe. This, listen to what he says. He likened Beyoncé to a dog attempting to leave its mark when he got interviewed on his position about other artists exploring various genres. And he also, like, threw in the left progressives, right? And this is, listen to his quote. The lefties in the entertainment industry just won't leave any area alone. See, I told you, they just don't want, they want something for themselves and no one else. He says, they just have to seize control over every aspect, don't they? And then he says, they've got to make their mark just like a dog and a dog would make their mark in a park. You know, every dog has to mark every tree, right? So that's what's going on here. That was his reference to Beyoncé entering into country music. Interesting, huh? You know, we have segments of our society. Let me say this before we take our first break. We have segments of our society that think racism is gone, that racism is over. As a matter of fact, I was thinking about our Lieutenant Governor, Mark Robinson, who's running for governor, who's the last person anyone should vote for. And Mark Robinson is like, he says, I am not African-American. He says, he not even light-skinned. Like, I could see if he trying to pass. But he's like a brown-skinned brother saying, I am not African-American. And then he's like, racism doesn't exist in America, because if racism exists in America, I wouldn't be lieutenant governor. And then we have groups of people, and some of them look like me and you, who like believe that propaganda. Let me ask you a question real quick. So for the people who say racism doesn't exist because I'm the example, because I got to the top of the barrel, because I ran a company, because I own a company, because I got elected in a public office. Let me ask you a question. If there were 100 deer running across Highway 64 or running across 540, 100 deer running across Highway 540, 99 deer get ran over and killed by tractor trailers and cars. One deer makes it across 540. One deer makes it across 64. When that deer is a special deer because the deer can talk. And then WRIL runs up to that deer with a microphone and says, listen, you made it across 540. You made it across 64. Is 540 dangerous for deers? Now, mind you, 99 deers have died. That deer would then say, no, 540 not dangerous for deers. Just because one person makes it across does not mean it's still not a toxic environment. And so don't believe that propaganda. Don't believe that garbage that gets spewed out. That is how Pharaoh works. That's how the enemy works. They will convince one person that you're different. You're elite. You're more smart. You're more acceptable. And because you're the one that's more elite, more acceptable, more smart, that means everything is fair game for everyone else. That is a lie from the pit of hell, y'all. So yeah, shout out to Beyonce for making it in the charts, crashing the charts on country music, still dealing with issues of racism. I'm gonna take a quick break. When I come back, I wanna talk about early voting. I wanna talk about some of the hot issues. I wanna talk about public education. I wanna talk about Black history. This is the James Galliard Show. I'm James Galliard. I'm gonna check out your comments on Facebook. You're welcome to call us in, 252-937-7400, the 919-872-9210. And I'll be right back.
Build.com. Click properties and North Carolina. You can rent or buy.
My people, welcome back to everybody. Glad you are joining me. Welcome back. I'm James Galliard. I want to talk a little bit about early voting. I'm looking at some of your comments on social media. You never know who's watching. You never know who's listening. State Senator Greg Meyer is shouting us out, talking about, I can't get Texas Hold'em out of my head. It's fantastic country. But Bay's version for sure, just like Ray Charles used to do it back in the day. Come on, man. That's my guy right there, State Senator Greg Meyer, shouting us out. So it's good to have you listening. I'm seeing everybody shouting us out, talking about some of the things that we are referencing today. I'm glad you're with us. Hey, listen, I want to talk a little bit about early voting. We are in early voting. I told you at the top of the show, I'm just not getting down with people who don't vote, okay? You can't work for me. You can't sing at my church. We just can't break bread together. I can handle people that don't vote like me, but I cannot deal with folk that don't engage in the process. So February 15th is when early voting starts. It ends on March 2nd, and then Election Day is March 5th. And so the time is winding down. Polls close tonight at 7:30 p.m. They are also open on the weekend on Saturday from 8 a.m. to 3 p.m. In Nash County, you've got a couple places you can vote at: the Ag Center, Braswell Memorial Library. There are 7 early voting locations in Durham County. There are 13 early voting sites in Wake County. And I want to encourage you. So I want to talk a little bit about what's at stake here. I pulled sample ballots. Some of you sent me messages saying, hey, can you talk about this race or talk about that race? So one of the questions I got were that folk were like, well, G, and y'all feel free to call me G. I prefer that, actually. And so people are like, well, G, why is it that my state representative's name is not on my sample ballot? Or why is it that my senator's name is not on the ballot? Because understand, if they are in an uncontested race in the primary, that means no other person of their political affiliation is running, then they will only appear on the general election ballot in November, okay? And so, like, for example, here in Nash County, where I am, we have someone running for House District 25, which is the seat that I've served in for 4 years, 2 terms I spent serving in House District 25. I've run 4 times for the General Assembly. If you don't think that the gerrymandering of seats, the moving around of lines so that we can cherry pick kind of who we want to represent and then kind of navigate and manipulate our way into election cycles is not real. Trust me, use me as an example. I've run 4 times. I didn't run this year. I've been working behind the scenes doing some other things, but I ran 4 times and I ran on 4 different and ran in four different districts. And so every time I ran, it got changed. And the hope was that eventually it would get changed so I would not be able to win it. And if you're black and in the East, you know, almost every black representative got drawn out of representation in the North Carolina General Assembly in Eastern North Carolina. When you look at going down I-95 going east, and even some parts above that, there were significant up in Vance County. Terry Garris, you know, drawn out. You had Raymond Smith early on in Wayne County. You had myself in Nash County. You had Linda Cooper Suggs in Wilson County. You had Howard Hunter, like in the Bertie area and out in that direction. I mean, literally, there was a systemic removal of representation for people of color east of I-95. That's why we have to vote. And let me just say this, and I know that my audience is Raleigh and Durham, and, you know, some other places, but I want to shout this out, and I'm going to include Wilson in what I'm about to say, but my people in Wilson, my people in Rocky Mount, my people in Roanoke Rapids, my folk in Tarboro, Scotland Neck, I want to encourage you to upset the electorate. If we can show up in big numbers, we can wield a political power that we have not been used to wielding. And so I want to lay that out for you. So if you see that you have a representative whose name is not on ballot, don't be confused by that. But know that they don't have someone of their political party running against them. Now, having said that, let me deal with something. Okay. Let me deal with something. And I'm told that I told you State Senator Greg Meyer had just chimed on in on Facebook. I hear he's on the call. Let me see if I can get our technicians to pipe in. I'd love to have a couple minutes with so I tell you what, let's do this. I'm at 5:25. We'll take a quick break, and then when we come back from the break, we're gonna bring on to the studio.
This is the studio.
Okay, let's do it. They say he's ready. Come on.
What's up, Pastor G?
Come on, man. What's up, Senator?
Happy to join you.
Man, it's
glad
good to
I got the word from your fine crew over there that I should call in.
Man, it's good to hear your
voice.
But
you're right on what you're talking about. You're right. The gerrymandering is designed to keep people's voices out, and the only way to change it is to have people take advantage of their constitutional right to vote. That's it. The numbers are there. If people will vote, the numbers are there.
And I appreciate you sharing that, because, and for those of you that don't know, because you don't see him in studio because he's calling in, but look him up, State Senator Greg Meyer. For folk that don't know you, Senator, tell them where you represent and just give us a quick, 60-second bio on you.
Yeah, I mean, so I represent Orange County, Person County, Caswell County, three very different counties. A really interesting look at how does North Carolina work when you go from UNC into one of the most rural and poor counties in our state. And I've been in the legislature for 10 years. It's crazy. I served with you for the 4 years that you were there. And before I got into this, I was working in North Carolina's public schools. So you and I often talk passionately about education.
Yeah, and I'm going to talk before I get out on the show today really passionately about education. I'm going to throw out four subjects for you. I want you to pick one, and I just have this much confidence in you, and just speak about why this issue, you just pick one, why this issue is important, and know that our audience is predominantly African American, is urban, is rural, but I'm gonna throw some issues out. Medical marijuana is the first one, gun rights, immigration, and abortion. Abortion, immigration, gun rights, or medical marijuana. Pick one and tell me why it's important that I vote as it relates to that issue.
This is like a political game show. I get to pick my topic. I love it. Nobody's ever done this for me before. I'm going with medical marijuana.
Medical marijuana for 200.
Actually more expansively.
Let's do it.
Yeah, exactly. I'm going with full legalization and full regulation of marijuana. I think that legalizing and regulating marijuana is actually one of the most important and powerful policy changes that we could do in North Carolina. I think that we, number one, have to decriminalize it and stop sending people to jail for low-level use. I think we have to regulate it so that our kids aren't buying it aren't buying the very close to marijuana stuff that they can get in gas stations right now.
Yeah.
I think we need to farm it and make it something that our rural communities can look to for revenue. And I think that we need to tax it and make sure that we're getting that money that right now is on the black market and taking it. And then the most important thing that we can do once we do tax it is we should reinvest all of that money that we make off of legalizing marijuana, and we should put it right back into the communities that have been hurt the most by the really damaging war on drugs. And I really wish Democrats would run on that, because I think that it's something that cuts across many, many communities, but definitely speaks directly to the black community, especially on the mass incarceration issue but then also on the economic prosperity issue of the possibility of allowing black wealth to be built through the cultivation of a marijuana industry that actually allows black folks to have some ownership in it.
Well, look, you don't know what you're going to hear on the James Galyard show. I'm with you fully, Senator. Let's educate everyone for a minute, because now I wasn't in this last session, but if I'm remembering my reading correctly, I want to say there was a medical marijuana bill that got across the Senate. I know Senator Bill Raybon was real big on this. I believe he might even be maybe a cancer survivor, I'm not sure, but I know he was really big on
this. Right.
I thought it got across the Senate, but then it got stalemated in the House. Is that correct?
That's exactly right. It's a medical-only bill. Senator Raymond has bragged that it's the most conservative bill in the country, and it's got two major problems with it. One is that it's actually really restrictive in terms of who can use it. And to be that restrictive, you're going to have to spend so much money on regulation and policing of who's able to legally use the medical product that you actually take away all of the tax revenue that you would gain from starting to sell it legally. So it doesn't pay back the monetary dividend. But the other problem is the way the bill is constructed, it would put the entire industry, the growth of the product, the production of it, and the direct sales of it into the hands of 10 very large companies, which doesn't allow us to get wealth back for the communities that have been hurt the most by mass incarceration and the war on drugs. And, you know, it's really a corporate opportunity rather than an opportunity for us to take care of communities.
Man, you were probably, Senator, and I'm going to call you Greg because we operate like that. But Greg, you were probably one of the first political people that I heard talk about the importance of monetization of medical marijuana for the black community. And I think given the way that the black community has been dealt with in a criminal justice system relative to marijuana, it is only right that there is a reversal of that and that there is some opportunity to capitalize monetarily on it. And I really appreciate you bringing that to the forefront. I wish that we would have more conversation, even though I know we're not over the finish line on the legalization of medical marijuana. I wish we had fully gotten where we needed to go in terms of just decriminalizing it now. We already know at some point it's going to be legalized. I wish we had done more to decriminalize it. I wanted you to speak a little bit about the politicization of this because I felt like the reason it didn't get across the House is because there were people like the Speaker of the House, Tim Moore, and others who had other aspirations, maybe Congress or something else, and really wanted to appease a very conservative group and didn't want to have to worry about being primary and things like that. So am I off base on that? Was there like a highly politicization of this? Because I feel like if so, that motivates people to understand how important their vote is so that politicians aren't playing politics with their lives and their future. What say you, Senator Greg Meyer?
No, you nailed it. I mean, medical marijuana legalization gets polled at around 70 to 75% popular in North Carolina. Full legalization, maybe 10 points below that. So this is an issue that people are broadly supportive of. It is not a partisan issue. The whole reason why we haven't been able to do it is because the Republican Party that's in control has a fanatic piece of its base that is completely opposed to legalizing marijuana, and they're afraid to tick off that base. If you put my bill, the bill that I just laid out for you that includes reinvestment into communities hurt by the war on drugs, if you put that on the floor of the House or the Senate for an up or down vote, it would broadly pass. If you put it on the ballot in front of people in North Carolina, which we don't really have the ability to do, it would broadly pass. The whole thing that's holding this up is internal politics within the Republican Party.
So you've heard it, folks. Internal politics, which is why we need to get out and vote. Our vote matters. Our vote gives us our voice, and I want to encourage you to get that vote out. We are in the midst of early voting. There are a litany of issues: public education, gun rights, immigration, abortion, medical marijuana, gambling. I mean, just everyday paying my bill issues, that economic issues that impact all of us. And so I got to pay a bill real quick and take a break. Senator Greg Meyer, thank you for hanging out with me today.
Great to be with you. Great show. Talk to you again soon.
All right, thanks. Take care. We'll be right back after this message.
Pop's Diner, 132 South Church Street, Rocky Mount. Juicy burger, hot, delicious wings, yummy spaghetti, and the first pizza to ever be served downtown Rocky Mount. Hot, delicious pizza and more at Pop's Diner. Pop's Diner for hot dogs. Pop's Diner for lunch. Open daily from 11 till 7 p.m. City workers get the Pop's hookup. Pop's Diner, open from 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. Wings, pizza, burgers, spaghetti, salads, and more. Hot, fresh, and fast at Pop's Diner. 19th, or visit tthfamilydentistry.com. That's tthfamilydentistry.com. And here's something that will make you smile even brighter. Dr. Hinton can enhance your radiance with therapeutic Botox and smile enhancements. Therapeutic Botox and smile enhancements at TTH Family Dentistry. Look and feel your best self. TTH Family Dentistry. tthfamilydentistry.com.
Dad.
Yeah.
I've been reading since you got me.
Talk to me.
I know. This guy named Garrett Morgan, you know who that was?
Be real quiet. Sure you about to tell me?
Okay. You know the three light traffic signals?
I do.
Garrett Morgan invented that day in 1923.
For real?
He sure did. And he only had an elementary school education, Dad.
Who told you all that, Craig?
I read about it.
Okay.
And let me tell you what else, Dad. His mama and his daddy were slaves.
I'm proud of you, Craig. Great job, man.
Thank you, Dad. I told you I'd be studying.
MEDOC Metals, 280 October Lane in Enfield. All Black History Month. We're buying your scrap metal and paying you cash on the spot. Can't get it to us? We'll come get it. All you need is your title and registration, and we'll give you cash. Has 2024 been a strain? Do you need money fast? Call us, 252-883-1598. Do you have old appliances, old vehicles, all types of scrap metal? We'll pay you cash the same day. Call 252-883-1598. MEDOC Metals Infield.
Hey, Raleigh, your wardrobe deserves the royal treatment, and we've got just the place for you. Martinizing Cleaners, your new go-to dry cleaners in town. We know life gets busy, and that's why Martinizing Cleaners on Raven Ridge Road is here to make your life easier. Experience the convenience of pickup and delivery, same-day service, and trust us with our expert wash and fold service. Our non-toxic approach ensures your clothes and the environment stay fresh. And here's an exclusive offer just for you. Choice FM 92.1. When you visit Martinizing Cleaner and enjoy 50% off on comforters. Yep, you heard it right. 50% off just for being our valued customer. Martinizing Cleaner, 10911 Raven Ridge Road, Unit 101, Raleigh. Call 919-703-0007. Visit martinizing.com/Raleigh for more details. Martinizing Cleaner, because your clothes deserve the royal treatment.
Raleigh, the Universe Soul Circus is back and the crowds are going wild.
I say Big Chop, you say
Circus!
The Universe Soul Circus is only here for 2 more weeks.
So much fun. This was my first time and it was amazing. So much fun.
Bringing family and friends together under the big top.
Y'all better come check this out, because we don't know what you're missing.
And we don't want you to miss it, so get your tickets now. Only 2 weeks left at Walnut Creek. Tickets available at UniverseSoulCircus.com.
Levy Soul Cafe, located 23 Highway 98 in Boone. The finest in soul cuisine. Food so good, your tongue will slap your brains out.
Yeah, boy.
Open Wednesday through Sunday. The kitchen's open at 11 a.m. on Wednesday through Saturday. And at noon on Sunday. Serving hot and fresh soul food daily. Turkey wings, fried chicken, ribs, and pork chops. We talking cabbage, string, beans, yams, and some of the cheesiest mac and cheese you've ever tasted. Levy Soul Cafe. 23 Highway 98 in Bun. Down home cook like your grandmama used to make. Daily special like fried fish or oxtails. Ooh-wee. Levy Soul Cafe. 23 Highway 98 in Bun. Call 919-729-0744 for takeout and daily special. Levy Soul Cafe. Food so good, your tongue will slap your brains out.
Yeah, boy.
The James Gellier Show on Choice FM.
Your tongue will slap your brains out. My goodness, I heard that. Hey, y'all, welcome back. We're almost out of time already. Listen, I'm talking issues. I'm looking at some of your posts. I appreciate all of you. You need to vote. We're in the midst of early voting. I want to go ahead and speak to the elephant in the room. So people have been asking me, why is it that my state representative has a primary? And, you know, so if I live in Edgecombe County or I live in Halifax County, why is it that my state representative has a primary? So I want to deal with this. We have two long-standing legislators, Democratic legislators, one out of Halifax County and those areas, Representative Michael Ray, who's being primaried by Rodney Pierce, and then on Edgecombe and Martin County, Representative Shelley Willingham, who's being primaried by Abby Lane. You know, let me just say this, folks. I served in the General Assembly. I was never primaried. Now, I know lots of good legislators that are primaried. Generally speaking, folk get primary because there is some challenge, some concern, some level of dislike on voting record. Now, you know, what I will tell you is that not often is it about a single vote. You know, most of you know I'm a pretty moderate to right-leaning Democrat, you know, and so I could never be a Republican just because they don't love people enough and care about people enough, and they don't look out for all groups of people to the extent that I think we need to as elected officials, and there's other reasons as well. You know, but I remember voting in a way that, you know, people didn't like relative to an abortion bill. And, you know, and I got a threat of being primaried, but, you know, they walked it back out because the totality of my voting record was such that people felt like he still represents our community well. My experience has been, I'm not saying this is always the case, but my experience has been, because you got to recognize that in small communities, like if we live in Roanoke Rapids, if we live in Rocky Mount, we live in Tarboro, we're not Durham, we're not Charlotte. And so we are very close knit. It's going to be very likely we're going to wind up at the same Piggly Wiggly. We're going to wind up at the same Food Lion. We're going to wind up, every time I call out these places, by the way, I need to reach out to them about being sponsors on this show. But, you know, we walk into those places and we can tend to see people that are our elected officials. I can't tell you how many town hall meetings I had in the Food Lion or in Harris Teeter. And so it's difficult for us to message on something we dislike because we wind up at the football game together. We wind up at church together. It winds up very uncomfortable. So the average person that's voting, they're really not that conversant on a voting record of a representative. My experience has been is that when people will, when people begin to primary elected officials, particularly those who've been longstanding, it's because there are populations of people, and there's usually broad populations of people that are looking at the voting record, and they're kind of like, I don't really know that this is properly representing our county to the extent that we sent that person there to do, and then they wind up being primaried. And so you have two examples of that with two very longstanding representatives, and I know people are kind of like, I can't believe he's going here, but that's the whole point of the show, y'all, is to talk about stuff that people are just scared to talk about, right? And so you have a challenger in the person of Abby Lane with Shelley Willingham, and also with Rodney Pierce with Michael Ray. And so for those of you that are looking at your ballots in those communities, I would ask you to do a little deep dive, take a look at those voting records, ask why is this person being primaried? You know, ask what is really going on here. I can tell you a lot of times what happens is that it's, you know, you have to decide for yourself what matters the most. Is it bringing back the bacon, so to speak, into the district, which always has value, right? I mean, I need to bring some money back into my district. Or am I equally concerned or more concerned with making sure that we're passing public policy that really represents the broader interest of people and that are not further creating inequity in populations of people that we claim that we should be serving? And so I think it's interesting and I think it's healthy. You know, I'm one of those people that I'm pro-term limits. Like, I just don't think no one has any business serving at 90 years old, 80 years old. I don't think people have any business serving for 20, you know, I would say more than 20 to 20, I would say more than 20 years. I mean, because at the end of the day, things change and we should be raising up a new generation. And so I'm big on term limits. And I think at some point, you know, you need to just check on out and say, I'm going to make room for the next group of people. But if those of you that are in Edgecombe County and in Halifax County, take a careful look at those state representative seats, because they are being contested. So House District 27 in Halifax County, for example, are being contested with Rodney Pierce for Michael Ray. You also have in Halifax County a district court judge seat. I talked about district court judges and the significance of it. You have a couple, as a matter of fact. You have seat 3 and seat 4 in District 7 that are both up, and so I want you to be mindful of that. And then, of course, you've got some nonpartisan elections relative to the school board, the Board of Education. Please be careful that even though it says nonpartisan, you know, the reality of it is that they do have a political position, and you want to be clear about what that political position is. And so I'm happy to weigh in on some further balloting issue information. I already told y'all how I'm voting. Of course, you know, I have my concerns about President Biden, but he looks like he's going to be our nominee, and so he's going to have my vote. I'm voting for Josh Stein for North Carolina governor. I really wish Mike Morgan had gotten into the race a little bit earlier. I think there was a lot of delay, lots of groups. I saw NCAE and other groups that had already jumped on the Josh Stein bandwagon by the time Mike decided to jump in. I think Mike is a fine human being. I think he would make a great elected official in any regard because he was a great jurist, and I appreciated his service to our state. I think he's brilliant, and I think he would do good work, but I think he jumped in a little bit too late, and we were already there to support Josh Stein. I think he'll be ready on day one. Lieutenant Governor, I already told you, Rachel Hunt is the person I'm going to be voting for. That's Mark H. Robinson. That is not Mark Robinson, our Lieutenant Governor. That's a different person. Santana DeBerry, I'm thrilled that she is running. I really am. She's brilliant. She is gritty. She is she's trusted. She cares about people. I think she would be an extraordinary Attorney General. I'm struggling a little bit. I'm just going for it, y'all, okay? So, because I don't think it's any benefit for me being on the program, having my own show with my own name, and then being scared of other people whose name is not on the show. You know, I was frustrated by our governors, and y'all know the governor is a friend. I served under the governor. I've been a great supporter of our governor, and I continue to be a great supporter of our governor. But understand this, just because you are a supporter of someone does not mean you agree with everything they do and say. You know, that's called a puppet. And I think part of the problem with our politics is that we are scared to confront each other. We're afraid to say, man, I don't agree with you on that decision. And so we have to learn to think bigger and broader than singular issues and look at across the board how things are done. Like, I went through this, you know, when I was toying with the possibility of running for Congress, you know, and when I was toying with the possibility of running for Congress, it was when I was expecting that there would be kind of a neutral primary, right? And that whoever entered into the primary would have equal opportunity to prove their point as to why the people should vote for them. You know, and as I got into that process, the rules changed midstream for me. And the decision was made to endorse a person that was running for Congress, you know, who's Don Davis. And so as a respect to G.K. Butterfield, who was outgoing, I backed out of that race, even though I very much wanted to serve in that capacity. Here's my point. You know, I think in a situation like G.K., I will agree that, you know, he served with distinction. He has a right to say this is the person that I think would best represent the 1st Congressional District. He has the right to do that. He did that. I think it should have been me, but that's okay. But I think in the situation of the governor and how he has outwardly jumped on Josh Stein and outwardly jumped on Allison Riggs, I'm struggling with that. And he's, you know, there's been a big promoting by the party of Jeff Jackson. And so there is this movement afoot that has, as us as Democrats, saying, you know what, we want everybody to go with the party machinery, and we want to decide who's next. And this is the reason why I am fighting so hard to get the rural Eastern North Carolina vote out, because we need to say to the party, y'all do not get to tell us who is up next. And so as far as we're concerned, Jeff Jackson is not up next, Santana DeBerry is. And as far as we're concerned, Laura Cubbage is up next, not Allison Riggs. And listen, no, I love Allison Riggs. I really do. But I don't think she gets to come up next, you know. And so we're going to give you Josh, okay? But you can't have no clean sweep of this. And so this is where we need to learn to be more inclusive as a party, and where we need to bring varying positions at the table and say we need to decide more as a conglomerate, as a group, as a collaborative, who is up next. And so, you know, I'm looking through my ballot and I'm like, you know what, you know, it's going to be, I mean, you've got Rachel Hunt already kind of in that mainstream. Her father, Governor Hunt, was, I think, what, he was governor for what, 4 terms, right? I mean, so what was that, 16 years? And so she's already a party favorite. You've got Josh, who kind of grew up, came up through those ranks. And then they want to kind of go ahead and add Jeff Jackson and add Allison Riggs to that equation. No, y'all can't have a clean sweep of this. So we're giving you Rachel Hunt. We're giving you Josh Stein. Do you know the power y'all have on this program? Y'all trust my voice on this. And we vote in large numbers, and we vote the way I'm recommending. You don't have to vote the way I'm saying, but we produce that big vote. We send a message out that creates a pocket of power in rural Eastern North Carolina that can sway the economics, the educational system, job growth, companies coming, farming, all of it can change. if we have the willingness to get out and vote. So many of you are saying, I already voted, but I want you to use your sphere of influence so that other people will vote as well. So reach out to other people in your Divine Nine. Reach out to people in your family. Reach out to your children. Reach out all across. I'm sending an email out to my entire staff today reminding them you have to vote. And so I've already talked to you about Mo Green. He's going to be on. Natasha Marcus is my choice for North Carolina Commissioner of Insurance. North Carolina Superintendent of Public Instruction, Mo Green is by far. This is easy. This might be, I think Mo Green and Santana DeBerry, for me, well, there's a couple more, but they're like no-brainers. Like, they're just no-brainers. There should not be any real discussion about them. Wesley Harris, this dude has like a PhD in economics. So how about, let me say this real quick. We'll take a quick break. So how about, you know, the sponsorship piece comes up on my Facebook page. The sponsorship thing comes up, ad comes up on my Facebook page for Gabe Esparza, Esparza. And, you know, I just happened to, you know what? You showed up on my feed, so I get to do what I want to do on my feed. It's my feed. So I just type in, like, you know, I'm voting for Wesley Harris. I've never met, never been, no one has ever come to me saying vote for this guy, Gabe. There's never been an email, a phone call, a visit to the church, anything, right? And so how about I get this, like, nasty little response telling me I'm an uninformed voter because I'm not voting for him? And so then he sends me a link to, like, this bill, and the link to the bill is, like, some stuff that the Biden administration is doing that he's evidently taking credit for that doesn't list his name anywhere. But he's telling me that because I'm voting for Wesley Harris, I'm uninformed, like most people are with people that have worked for the federal government. Sir, I'm not uninformed. I just don't know you, you know? And so make it a point. The fact that you think you can get elected without the black church, sir, tells me a whole lot of information. Wesley Harris has been around. He has shown up at our state convention. He's shown up at our church. He recognized, I want to get elected. I need the black church to help me. So the fact that you think you can't get elected without the black church, deuces for you. Sorry, bro. I'm going to go with Wesley Harris. And then, of course, Laura Cubbage. And so I'm going to take a quick break. I have about 5 minutes left after break. Y'all been so patient. Listen to me. I'm going to see what your responses are. Then I'm going to talk a couple more issues. And then I'm going to have to get to education next week. I'm devoting the whole show, well, not the whole show, not next week, the week after that, because I need to talk more election, because that's the Tuesday and Monday before Election Day. Anyway, this is the James Galliard Show, and I'm James Galliard. We're taking a quick break, and we'll be right back.
James Gellier Show on Choice FM.
My people, y'all gonna stop talking about my mayo choices, okay? And yeah, it's crazy to put ketchup on hot dogs. I stick by my positions as it relates to food. Anyway, I'm James Gellier. Welcome back. I'm out of time, but I am certainly not out of talk. I'm out of clock, but I'm not out of content. I've been trying to press the issue of why we need to vote. The polls are still open. Who's going to send somebody to the polls before 7:30 tonight? Let me leave you with, we talked in great detail today about medical marijuana, what the future of that may be. Let me raise up two other issues. Next week, I'm going to have hopefully some more people to interview as we go into Tuesday being Election Day. The following Tuesday, I'm going to dedicate the whole show to public education because we need to talk in detail about school choice. We need to talk in detail about school budgets. We need to talk about this ridiculousness in Halifax County having three separate school districts. We need to get into all that. So I'm going to dedicate a whole show to that. Before we get out of here today, let me raise up a couple more issues that were hot this legislative cycle that makes you want to kind of think about it and say, you know what, I really need to vote. Gambling was a big issue. This whole contentious fight about casinos. This is what I want you to leave you with. Whether you agree or disagree with the gambling and the casinos, this is the piece I want you to grab. That Senator Phil Berger was entire. He is the leader on the Republican side on the Senate. For those of you who don't know the name Phil Berger, he has a son who's on the state Supreme Court. That's a whole nother fiasco. He was willing and did hold up the entire state budget so he could get gambling passed. When I'm talking about holding up the entire state budget, I'm talking about holding up raises for teachers, holding up funding for public schools, holding up benefits for disabled people and veterans, holding up the expansion of healthcare coverage and Medicaid expansion. He was willing to literally disrupt the lives of an entire state so he could get his little pet bill passed on casinos in North Carolina. And so whatever your position is on casinos, know this. We don't need people in elected office who are willing to hold the state hostage so they can have their way. This is a democracy. This is not an authoritative government where you get to put on the crown as king and determine what policies are going to be most beneficial for everybody else. No, you've got to take into account what is most important for the populace, for everyone, for the 10.5 million people that live in our state and the 7.5 million voters that live in our state. And so gambling was a big issue, medical marijuana. I'll leave you with this, gun rights. What day doesn't happen we don't see somebody else shot? Fayetteville, Durham. And we live in a gun culture. But our legislators, particularly our Republican legislators, are not helping. And so literally, they passed legislation to eliminate the pistol permit requirement. So there's no pistol permit requirement. When I got my handgun, I had to go to the sheriff before I got my concealed carry permit, and he had to sign off. I had to get a permit to be able to buy. We totally bypassed that now, which I don't believe the sheriffs would agree with that at all. And then they tried to eliminate concealed carry permits, but they didn't get that one across the finish line. And it's crazy because, you know, literally you eliminate concealed carry permits and you got a bunch of people walking around with handguns that are concealing and they can't even shoot straight, right? They can't even pass a test. It's like putting someone behind the wheel of a car and we don't even know they can drive. How crazy is that? Folks, we need to vote. Whether it's gun rights or immigration or abortion or public education or medical marijuana or gambling, or just getting good, healthy food on your kitchen table, or making sure your child gets back home from school every day, we need to vote. I'm James Gellier. This is the James Gellier Show. I'll be back next Monday from 5 to 6. We're going to go through the ballot. We're going to lead you up to Tuesday, Election Day. And then the following week, we're going to talk in great detail about issues that matter the most, especially public education. If there's something you want me to talk about, this is your show. It just happens to have my name on it. I'm out of clock, but I'm not out of content. Out of time, but not out of talk. This is James Gellier. Thanks for joining us. I'll see you next week.
The James Gellier Show on Choice FM.
This is
WRSV, Elm City.
Turn up!
Choice FM.